for instance, the census. Let's talk about the census. I appreciate the census because I enjoy going through ancestry.com and seeing the signature of people like my great great grandparents. I never would have known my great great grandparents' name, to be honest with you, if it weren't for the census. So I'm okay with it. And of all the things that the government does, it's like I'm outraged at kids in cages, bombing children in Yemen, assassinating American citizens without a warrant, domestic spying, and then like 2,000th on the list is asking how many people live in my household. So like when it comes to outrages, you just I can't be outraged about everything all the time. It's just not how I want to live my life. I save it for the more important things. So I forgot to fill out the census. I didn't fill it out. I have robbed my future generations will never know that their great great grandfather lived alone in an apartment with two cats. They suspected it because he was a libertarian podcaster, but they didn't know that he was just a lonely simp living on his own. And so I've robbed them because it's October 17th and I log onto the census website and I can't actually take the census anymore. And I'm like, it's not the end of 2020. What the hell's going on? And, and Rhinehold has said, he's like, I don't like the census. They should just ask one question.
And I agree. I think so. The mandate in the Constitution was that they ask who lives, they know how many people live in each house
and why.
That's all they need to know. All the other information they're using to sell you stuff. It's like marketing, right? That when they try to get all your information so they can target ads to you, that's really all that is they're going to target the laws to try to get the most people so they can get the votes so they can keep the power. I don't want to give them that information, but I do want to give them how many people live in my house because that's important to the representation that comes out of it. The problem is this year is that unlike every other census I filled out, when I have filled out a few, I'm a little old. This is the first year I could not just fill out that question and be done. You go to the website to fill it out. They don't give you the form in the mail anymore that you can just mail back in. It was all on the website. You go there, you fill out that first question, and then you can't stop. You can't push finish and be done.
It's become a data collection service.
Yeah. So you give it false info and you keep going. So I make over $500,000 a year podcasting. I was kind of weird about doing the census. I was weirded out about doing the census this year because normal people problem. I had two houses, so I don't know which house I should fill the census in. So I just did one. Hope that was correct.
Yeah, it's really become a data collection service. Let me show you the website. You know, when you look at the Census Bureau website, you know, it's explore data, browse topic, age and sex, business and economy, education, Hispanic origin, population, housing, income, poverty, you know, library, like, all right. Does the government need to know that information? Is that important? In my opinion, no. Is it helpful that it exists? Yes, but
if we're supposed to treat every individual the same in via the government, like all our government laws should treat everybody individually the same, and all of our institutions should be doing that. All the stuff related to the government should be treating everybody as an individual. Then why does any of that need to be known?
So do I have it right? Do I have it right that they do count or have they have never? So this guy, his estranged daughter, she apparently hated his guts. But when this GOP strategist died in 2019. His name was Thomas Hoffeller, and he was like the guy in terms of gerrymandering, and he was the wizard behind the curtain in terms of gerrymandering. And he died, and he's the one who was the driving force on putting on the census a question: "Are you a legal citizen or not?" Which I'm surprised didn't exist or what. So essentially what happens is your census workers go out in the neighborhoods, they knock on the door, I got like 10 pieces of mail to remind me. I got people knocking on my door in my neighborhood. My neighbors upstairs were like, census people are in the neighborhood, don't answer your door. I know of three households in this neighborhood alone of young people that just didn't answer it. But, you know, you answer the door in a Hispanic area and there's no question on it. Are you a citizen? Are you going to vote? And what this guy and what they wanted to put in was that question. Are you a citizen? And what that would do is essentially decrease the amount of tallies in Democratic districts. So then the Republicans could go in and say, well, you know, and this was a whole stated intent in these documents, because some of it was public, but then she sent it to the Times and they published it last year after he died. Mr. Hofeller's exhaustive analysis of Texas state legislative districts concluded that such maps would be advantageous to Republicans and non-Hispanic whites and would dilute the political power of the state's Hispanics. The reason, he wrote, was that the maps would exclude traditionally Democratic Hispanics and their children from the population count. That would force Democratic districts to expand to meet the Constitution's one-person, one-vote requirement. In turn, that would translate into fewer districts in traditionally Democratic areas and a new opportunity for Republican mapmakers to create even stronger gerrymanders. So that was a big part of the problem. And then there was... So let me ask you guys. I'm not going to pretend that, like, I'm mad about it. Like, if you're not voting, why should we count you? Am I wrong? Like, I haven't thought it through deeply or read arguments one way or the other, but like my first take on it is, why should we count a person who is not actually voting?
Why are you not voting? Is are you not
voting? They're not legal citizens. They're illegal.
No, but that's just it. Is it because they're not legal citizens, or is it because they just don't want to vote?
Right. Because you're not right.
If they're asking if they're illegal citizens, I'll say here's the thing about that, and I want to get into this because this has kind of gotten diluted in the whole conversation.
Get the big cup of coffee.
I know. The representation it's supposed to be for the people who live in the area that's being represented, not the people who are citizens in the area that are being represented, but the people. Now those people cannot vote because they're not citizens. But they still need representation. Their lives are still being affected by the laws put in place in that area. So therefore, they should be counted as who's going to be there. And that was the whole point with the problem with the two-thirds compromise in the Constitution, because they wanted to count the people who couldn't. I mean, they're counting women back in the beginning of the country, but women couldn't vote. They were counting black people. Black people couldn't vote, right? But they were still counting them because they're being there was representation. They needed to be represented in the government so that people could say, hey, we got to think about these people too.
All right. So
go ahead, Harry. A
couple of things, right? Not every white person also couldn't vote when the Constitution was up. That was just for landowners. That was landowners.
Landowners only. Right? 30% of those in the country could vote or something.
Correct. Yeah.
They counted everybody.
Thanks for the great Andrew Jackson. Make sure everyone could vote in this country. I'm sure he did nothing else bad. So let's
look it up because we're sure nothing bad happened there.
Nothing bad ever. Don't ever look at that. And he did something with the central bank, but other than that, stop looking. To me, I'm with that. It also goes to that the idea of what makes a citizen. I think the idea that people who are quote unquote like the citizenship thing, it's you could be a citizen of the town, maybe not be able to vote into the federal elections. I see that, but if you live in that town, you've been in that town for 20 years, you have more right than anyone else to vote in the election to figure out what the town's going on, depending on which imaginary line that you're born on. You know, maybe you're not because you don't have the federal club membership, maybe, you know, and you have to pay for the federal club membership, but there's no, you know.
Well, the idea behind citizenship, I'll get back to you real quick, but the idea behind citizenship was to just have a way to prove that people who are coming in here who weren't born here had some investment in the country. They weren't just coming in, voting, being a citizen, and then leaving every 6 months or something like that, like migrant people.
Yeah.
It was supposed to be people who are invested in the future of this country, but it's gotten out of hand on trying to make that argument stick. Now it's like there are people who have green cards for 30 years that can't get citizenship, or people who are trying to get green cards for 20 years and they can't get into the country, and it's just gone crazy off the deep end.
Yeah,
but there was that thought process,
and the process is still incredibly hard and difficult. We've got the entire IT team for the company that I work for trying to get one of our team members like his citizenship. Like this is what we're doing. This is our side project. You know, and it's just like this. Why is this so difficult?
Why does it cost $10,000 minimum? I mean, to do. I mean, it is crazy.
The lottery too.
Yeah. So yeah. By your logic, Rhinehold, you know, a lot of discussion lately on adding court packing. We'll get to some other time, because that's like the 2018 midterms with the caravans. Court packing's not going to happen. But, you know, by your logic, should Puerto Rico and Washington, D.C. be admitted as another state? And my problem with that is that it, the whole system set up on balance. Anytime a state was brought in through the 1800s, you'd have one state on one side and they bring in another, or they create states. So there was always a continual system of balance. Mm-hmm. But by your logic, if you extend, right, for slavery, but when you extend your logic, you then give a 4-seat Senate majority permanently almost to the Democratic Party. But you Why? Give representation to the Puerto Rico and Washington, D.C. citizens.
So, A, they're still having laws that we create that affect them. And B, why are they permanent Democratic strongholds? Is it because the Republicans have spent so many years and money and time keeping them down? I mean,
yeah,
the
only group that Donald Trump hasn't alienated in terms of blocks of voters are QAnon and white supremacists. Like, you know, there is a lot of validity to your argument in that Republicans have not tried. The culture is changing. The citizens and the millennial and Gen Z generations are changing. And the message, by and large, from the Republican Party is not viable. Like, the world is moving on from you, which they tantrum. And so that's what a lot of this show is about, is what legal means do we have to preserve our power? Because fuck all these people for moving away from us, for leaving us. You know, libertarians, like, we're the canaries in the coal mine. Now, I said this to my friend Mike, who runs the Young Republicans here in the state. I go, I was sympathetic to the argument that Donald Trump did a lot of good stuff for libertarian, you know, ideals in January. I thought Eric Holcomb was a fairly decent governor in some respects in January. Mm-hmm. I would crawl over heaping hot coals to vote against the two of those people after their performance in 2020. You know, libertarians in the Libertarian Party would probably prefer to be a part of one of the other two major parties, because it would just make life a lot easier. We'd be part of winning campaigns, but we exist in this ecosystem because you two suck. You know, you're the ones who radicalized us. And there is some validity to your argument that it, so what? Like, you wouldn't have a Democratic, like, Republicans, as we discussed in the last, Republicans had a map that was going to give them more seats in 2020. Mm-hmm. And they blew it.
Yep.
They're the ones who blew it. Donald Trump is the one who's lost all these, Donald Trump is the one who lost, and it's always the media's fault. There's always an excuse. There's never some navel gazing going, mm-hmm. maybe we're the problem. And so if there is a permanent majority in the Senate, you're probably right. Like, it's on them.
But it's not permanent. That's what I'm saying, is if the parties would start representing the people's thoughts and needs in that district of the new Puerto Rico or the DC, mm-hmm. then maybe that party would get them people to vote for them. It's right. This idea that this state is, you know, California is red. That's it. Right. It didn't be. California was Republican like 40, 50 years ago. Yeah, they elected Ronald Reagan as their governor, God's sake. It's the way times change and society change, and how the parties react to that and how they represent their people, that all changes that, and it goes in flux. And this idea of a permanent anything is just really silly.
That's correct. Hold on, Harry. I have a brilliant point to make. That's part of the argument against the Electoral College people who want to get rid of it. Like, there's fluidity in the states. Like, you're viewing, I say to this to Ryan all the time, I'm like, you're viewing the current red-blue map as a permanent state. It's never going to change. When there's generational cycles, just like you mentioned, like Indiana flip-flops, mm-hmm. Ohio is going to be a swing state again now. You know, like, because our politics is fluid, so are our states in the Electoral College. But we'll get to the point where, ironically, the Electoral College may be the thing that saves Biden from losing to Trump, which will be hilarious, and I'll never stop laughing at Ryan. Go ahead, Harry.
All right. So, like, you're right. Everything is moving. Texas is moving. Everything is just changing. And it was this election is Trump's to lose. New York could have been in play if played correctly, if the Republicans did what they should have done, New York could have been in play and won New York. Just brilliant move. But they didn't. They just kind of like laughed at it and poked fun at it. Like, did you guys could have got New York? You know that? Because they were really pissed off at Cuomo and they were locked down. They're like, you had these people. You have all these people that are angry and pissed off. You could have did something, but you didn't. I really thought my heart of hearts was believing that New York could have been in play, and it's just not.
Yeah, they blew it. They blew it. So the Bloomberg has a brand called City Lab, and they posted a long article detailing some of the census stuff and why it matters and what's going on. And it's titled "The 2020 Census is Being Sabotaged," says leading U.S. statistician, posted on the 15th. And I'm just going to pull some of the quotes here. So, quote, the population count. So they talked to this statistician who focuses on the census, and let me give his name for the sake of interest. So Robert Santos, vice president and chief methodologist at the Urban Institute and president-elect of the American Statistical Association. Those are the groups. So the population count is responsible for making decisions about trillions of dollars in federal funding, and Santos did not mince words about how distorted the undercount could be. The coronavirus pandemic forced the Census Bureau to extend the window for going door-to-door to count households, and that had not yet responded. People like us, people like me, people like my, you know, girlfriend, like we're younger. Who takes their sweet time to fill out their census? Younger people. So we didn't get counted. We're not counted here in this district in Marion County. So now that undercount will be represented in both state and local and federal races and districts when the districts are redrawn this year. So there will be a disproportionate amount of younger people not counted. Instead of wrapping up operations in July, the Census Bureau, with the support of the White House, set a deadline of October 31st. The agency also asked Congress to move the date for submitting the final count from December to April 2021. Then the ground shifted. In July, the White House decided it wanted the data sooner, announcing that the final count was due in December after all, and the non-response follow-up should wrap up early to give the agency time to finalize the data 5 months earlier than the Census Bureau requested. I do not believe that a fair and accurate census can occur, Santos said. I expect it to be one of the most flawed censuses in history. The court decision alone is not responsible for this looming disaster, Santos said. Any undercount will be the result of a perfect storm of factors, starting with a call to add a citizenship question to the census that was rejected by the Supreme Court in 2019. In subsequent months, the president asked the Census Bureau to use administrative data to determine the citizenship status of every American adult and issued an executive order to exclude undocumented immigrants from the apportionment of congressional districts. Plus, the White House installed several hand-picked appointees inside the Census Bureau. Heard that one before. Leading to internal fears of political interference, see the FDA and CDC. Critics said the administration was fulfilling a secret plan by the late Thomas Hofeller, the GOP's so-called Michelangelo of gerrymandering, to use the citizenship question to give a boost to Republicans and non-Hispanic whites. Then came the pandemic. My suspicion, Santos continues, is that congressional allocation is going to be a done deal. If the actual whole person counts are used, regardless of the flaws that everyone knows are going to be baked into the census, population counts are used as the basis for the next 10 years of population projections, and those projections are used for really important studies and to issue federal funding to the tune of $1.5 trillion per year. It's possible that one could do some independent research first to identify the areas of problems geographically in terms of undercount or overcount, college students, duplicates, and such, and second, to come up with an estimate for what that was so a correction could be made to the population projections. Rather than starting with a severely flawed census and then baking those errors in for the next 10 years of population projections, one could start with those and make adjustments for known deficiencies. But so they go on to talk about, so why the census question, why change the deadline? What are the reasons in this person's view that this is taking place at the level of the president? There are two potential reasons. Both are nefarious. The first is that it allows you to do hyper gerrymandering. Before, block groups were so big that you could have a block group where part of it covered a minority neighborhood and part of it covered a non-minority neighborhood. There was no way of splitting that up. By getting down to the block level, like the city block, it will allow state legislatures to decide for themselves if they want to use citizenship counts rather than total population counts to create their state legislative boundaries. Not a Republican thing, because Democrats are going to win in probably a big blue wave at the state and federal levels. They're going to be the ones drawing the maps, which is so funny that it's such a self-owned by the Republicans that they didn't ditch this guy in an effort to get better maps for the next 10 years. Instead, they have realized their error and that they're going to lose all these state legislatives and governorships and senates and all this stuff in these lower ballot races. So they're freaking out trying to figure out how to salvage the next 10 years and not give Democratic majorities because of gerrymandering. The gerrymandering in this year is going to be absolutely insane on both sides, trying to give themselves. That's why we should have maps drawn by AI. If AI infects every area of our life, why doesn't it draw the maps for us here? If they decide to use so two blocks next to each other, one of them goes to one district and the other goes to the other district based on the immigration stuff. What's the potentially nefarious purpose behind the White House plan? The other one, the first is hyper gerrymandering. The second is enforcement. The Census Bureau collects information for statistical purposes, not for enforcement purposes. The notion of these counts ever being used for enforcement, basically targeting high population, low citizenship count blocks for ICE raids or whatever, that would be really, really problematic. That would be almost surely results in lawsuits. The Census Bureau doesn't want that. Most of the public doesn't want that. The interviewer asked, do you believe that the census is being rigged to produce an outcome that is favorable to Republicans? No, I wouldn't say it's being rigged. It's being sabotaged. And so, you know, that's a big part of the census plays into gerrymandering on both of these teams. And they'll go through and they will draw a neighborhood in different parts. So that's why the census story matters, because it's one of those things you're not paying attention to now, but in 2 to 3 to 4 years when you're like, why are there so many more Democrats? Well, it's because the Republicans lost a lot of legislatures this year because of making excuses for Donald Trump. And then the Democrats gerrymandered the crap out of all these various districts at the state and federal level and local level and gave themselves an advantage, because that's exactly what the Republicans did 10 years ago. And you know who pays the price? All of us regular people who aren't paying attention. They benefit from it. We don't. Any thoughts?
AI is not the solution. AI is terrible. Don't do it. That's trash. AI is programmed by a human. Human has biases. Humans are flawed. Their code that they can produce is also flawed. You believe that AI... Yeah, AIs can be manipulated. AI is not this nonpartisan being in the corner. It has biases. It has, you know, like that. And we watch algorithms all the time shift and change based off of their, you know, how people program and how many people manipulate it. Code has issues.
You know, I have no idea what the solution is for the gerrymandering thing, because it is horribly being abused and has been for decades. Mm-hmm. You've got a district in North Carolina that almost runs the entire state about 5 miles wide.
Yeah. So let me,
that representative of a community, mm-hmm, when you're talking about people in your district who are 150, 200 miles away from you.
Right.
It doesn't make any sense.
Right.
I think the number of representatives we have too isn't representative of what it was supposed to be. Right. That is the other big problem too. We need to get more, mm-hmm, representatives in the House, but that's probably a whole other conversation.
Yeah, I think increasing the number of representation, decreasing those districts is a good way to do it. I think the biggest solution to deal with the gerrymandering problem is to remove a lot of the power the government does have against you. That's the biggest power. So the gerrymandering thing, okay, ooh, exactly. The gerrymandering again in this year. Ooh.
Well, or non-governmental organization that studies this stuff and comes up with an unbiased representation of what current neighborhoods and communities look like in your area should be the way to go. But that's never going to happen because the people who are in power are gerrymandering to keep themselves in power, to prevent that from happening, to keep themselves in power.
Right.
So I'm going to make this full screen, so I'm not going to be able to see it, but you guys tell me if it looks right or not. But so in 2009, I was executive director of the Libertarian Party of Indiana, and had a good relationship with the then Secretary of State, who's running for Attorney General, Todd Rokita. He appointed me to the Help America Vote Act Commission. I always got along with him. I always liked him. And it was political courage to do what he did. And he put together something called Rethinking Redistricting. So I'm going to make this full screen. All right, good. So you can't see it. All right. So
I'm a big fan of this when it came out too.
Yes. And so what Rokita did as Secretary of State was said, let's redraw the legislative districts to better represent people and not politics. And so he talked about, and I'll put this in the show notes so you can see the document for yourself. This document I had to archive because when the new Secretary of State came in, he deleted it and made sure nobody ever saw this again. Here we are 10 years later because I'm annoying. And so he worked with the Brennan Center and Common Cause, which is all over voting issues. Great resource. We cite them a lot on these two episodes because they are a nonpartisan, great organization. And he worked with them to say, all right, so let's say fair maps existed. What would those look like for Indiana? And, you know, he points out that if you were in Terre Haute, Indiana, which on the west side of Indiana, if you're thinking of it like a boot, you know, and the boot kind of tilts towards the west, towards California, Terre Haute's on the left side in the smack dab middle. Evansville is down at the very bottom of the boot. Milwaukee is just up above Chicago. The district that in the 8th district for the last 10 years, if you live in Terre Haute, or if you live in the top of the 8th district in Indiana, for instance, right here, you are closer to Milwaukee than you are to Evansville. So, you know, none of these maps really made sense. And so he put together on the left. So here's the existing map of House districts. Mm-hmm. And so you have, you know, all these wild, crazy maps, and they're all like weirdly drawn. And it's basically they split neighborhoods and communities in half because on this side, it's a bunch of Democrats, and on this side, it's a bunch of Republicans. And so for 10 years, we've really only had about half a dozen state house races that are competitive because it saves the other two parties money. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't benefit the people of Indiana. And so he put together these maps that try to include and keep intact different counties and include various fair groups. You know, House, that's the state Senate map. This is the House legislative map. And this is even weirder. Look at this one over here where you have this big, like, it like is hugging another district, you know? And so you look at this one that goes from Indianapolis to Richmond, this long one, you know, instead of it just being Henry County and blocking it kind of like this, they just used basically census data, just how many people live in an area. Let's draw the maps, not using political data of who votes in what way on these blocks. You know, the congressional districts, if you live here, you're closer to Milwaukee than you are down here. You know, so this is a much fairer drawing of the map because it's drivable as opposed to not drivable. So using all kinds of, you know, data showing community split, this is a town totally split. So it's a great visual representation of the problems that are taking place in Indiana. And this happens everywhere because all sides do it.
Right.
Well, Todd Rokita pissed off the Indiana House and Senate Republicans so badly. He was going to run for Senate in 2012. He pissed them off so badly with this that he wasn't able to run because he tried to do the right thing and he got punished for it. You know, and so that's this data that is being pulled for the census is going to be used for this kind of stuff for these purposes and other purposes like rounding up illegals. So if that's your thing, cool. But just so you are paying attention to the census issue and why it matters and what when you're looking back going, how did this happen? Think about this episode.